Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Ali Velshi from Al Jazeera America, and I'd like to welcome you to ATA's Tourism Day and the 9th Annual Presidential Forum on Tourism. A welcome to our ministers of tourism from various African nations joining us in the front row. Thank you so much for being with us. And so far, so good in terms of traffic. We've got a few people delayed, but not bad for the beginning of what is the busiest and biggest week in New York. Always an honor to be here. A little bit of a more complicated year this year for Africa and the issues of tourism. The situation, particularly in West Africa with Ebola, sort of illustrates a lot of the issues that we all face when it comes to tourism in Africa and the portrayal of Africa in the media. On one hand, West Africa needs the world to understand what's going on and the very specific challenges that Ebola presents. On the other hand, it is largely bad news. It's much more bad news than good news. There are isolated successes. There are remarkable stories of human strength. There are remarkable stories of charity and people who put their lives on the line. But ultimately, from a tourism perspective, infectious diseases are never a great thing. At the same time, certainly in the media, we face criticism that we do not sometimes do the thing that we are most often and clearly called upon to do, the one thing the media has to do above all else, and that is to bear witness, particularly in populations who are not at the forefront of the news or at the forefront of our minds. The allegation, and this is one of the reasons I so enjoy working with Al Jazeera, because we don't typically face that allegation, is that you just ignore us. You ignore us in good times, you even ignore us in bad times. So we have this challenge upon us in the media to bear witness. Sometimes there's very little we can do, but whether it is people dying of an infectious disease or failures to get the right help to them, or it is an ethnic minority trapped on a mountain in Iraq, without us, in many cases, the world wouldn't know. So what do we do? Do we tell the bad story that doesn't really help people want to go and visit these places, or do we ignore it altogether, which also, by the way, doesn't help people want to visit these places. So sometimes the story comes along in the form of, this is the challenge that these places are facing, this is how their governments and their aid agencies and their NGOs are dealing with it, and if that recipe is good, if the responses are positive, in which in many cases they have been, that may go a long way toward creating a good impression in people's minds about what those countries are. I don't think it helps anybody in the short term. Not only are we seeing cancellations in travel to West Africa, we're actually seeing cancellations in travel all around the world. A couple of instances in the last year have caused that. The disappearance of the first Malaysian Airways aircraft had a remarkable effect on cancellations, particularly with those airlines, with Malaysian and other airlines that operate on similar structures. The second airliner sort of made people understand that airlines travel through conflict zones and that there are people who have weaponry that they otherwise we didn't know that they had. There's generally, in times like this, travel takes a hit. There's no question. There's a certain amount of travel that doesn't take a hit because it has to happen, but a lot of particularly leisure and vacation tourism takes a hit outside of the United States, and we know that's the case. We now have added scrutiny here in the United States about ISIL and various groups sort of competing with each other for notoriety, and while they're busy trying to create statehood in Iraq and Syria, nobody wants to lose track of the best way to make an impact on Westerners and Western travelers is attacks focused on the West. So the traveler's mind is a little bit busy right now. It's a little bit occupied. And I want to tell you a little bit about this bearing witness story and how it affects us very directly. As you know, we have three of our colleagues in jail for coming on to a year now in Egypt for bearing witness to things that were going on there. We have had two journalists killed in Iraq, very brutally, very publicly. You know, and these are freelance journalists, by the way. We have used their work in the past, but they are freelancers because, generally speaking, they don't send staff journalists into the most dangerous of places if it can be avoided, because it's dangerous, and we know that. And when I travel to dangerous places, not only do we travel with a lot of insurance, we have special training to go into conflict areas or dangerous areas, and we generally, not generally, we always travel with security when we go into conflict zones. Well, these guys who got kidnapped didn't travel with security. And there was a meeting in Chicago the other day of major news organizations to say maybe we should all agree not to buy the work of these freelance journalists, because they go there on spec. They go to all of these countries on spec to write stories, and they're the stories you read in magazines. They're actually much better than the stories you'll see from staff journalists, because these are the people who take the risks. They know that if their story isn't better than everybody else's, it simply won't get published or picked up on TV. So they go into the worst places, and they tell these stories, and sometimes they get captured, and you see what happens to them. And by the way, they don't come with insurance policies that will pay out ransoms, if in fact a ransom is in order, although we haven't paid out ransoms. It's a policy of the United States and the UK and Canada not to pay out ransoms, and that's a different issue. But one of the interesting points, and the reason I'm talking about them in relation to this, is that the counter-argument, it seems obvious, there were people all around our newsroom saying, you know what, if we didn't pay these guys, if we didn't buy their stories, they wouldn't go to these places, they wouldn't get kidnapped, and they wouldn't get killed. Well, the flip side of that is if we didn't pay these guys and they don't go do these stories, you wouldn't know these stories. You simply wouldn't know the brutality, the despair, and the challenges people face. Now, when I move that back to Africa, it's not about brutality generally, although in some cases it is. We have two specific cases in Nigeria and in Kenya where we are seeing remarkable, vicious brutality. And Somalia, but some of that requires risk on the part of people who tell stories, and we have to bear witness. So we owe a duty to people who are suffering more than we owe a duty to good public relations. Now, that said, our first responsibility is to make sure we bear witness and tell you what is happening in these places. Along with that responsibility comes a responsibility to be fair and honest and tell you the good parts of those stories too. And I think with respect to Africa, we are doing a better job. Again, Al Jazeera, for those of you who see it here and in the world, does a particularly good job, largely because we have more people out there than anyone else. Al Jazeera has 84 bureaus around the world, which is more than the BBC and CNN combined. So we're in these places. We understand the nuances of these problems. Africa is not a strange place to us by any stretch. We have people who have worked, lived, and were born in Africa and have reported for their entire careers in Africa. And in most of Africa, not all, but in most of Africa, journalism is freely practiced and of a very high quality. It's also our job to point out those places where it's not, because where you cannot practice journalism freely, you are not safe to travel. It is as simple as that. Where we are not free to bear witness about what's going on, we will never recommend that you go to those places. But where you are free, where you are transparent, where governments let us in and let us operate freely to show what is going on, the good and the bad, those are the places that get written about and spoken about and create positive impressions in people's minds. And so that is the challenge that we face. I think this challenge will pass. We know it will. All estimates of what's going on with Ebola are that it will peak and it will dissipate. The issue is at what speed, and how quickly, and what will the toll be in the end. There's no real fear, as much as you'll see it sometimes on cable news, this fear about this being the greatest pandemic the world has ever seen. It is important for people to understand, as a germ, it has that capability. If no one were to be vigilant and no one were to do the right things and we were to allow it to spread, but really we all know that utilizing the right preventative measures, we can do that. And my only input on this is that those countries should continue doing what they're doing, being as transparent as possible, being as helpful as possible. The transparency is important. When people know we can get information, they generally feel safer about a situation. But it is our hope that when we convene again next year, we're not actually discussing this particular topic. We're back on track discussing all of the great things that are happening and the rebuilds that are occurring. And by the way, when something bad has happened, it generally presents a remarkable opportunity after that has passed for people to revisit these places and understand what their benefits are. So obviously in the world of tourism and travel, you want to be working quite far ahead on that, and that's why it's advantageous that we have this this gathering today where we can start to speak about it. We are joined today by the Honorable Ministers of Ghana, Tanzania, Kenya, Uganda, Zimbabwe, and various travel executives and professionals from those and other countries. I want to show you a video that was produced by Shirley Neal of Park Hill Entertainment before we get started with our proceedings. So please, the video.
The Africa Travel Association. We know Africa. We are the premier global travel trade association, the leader of Africa travel and tourism, bringing the world to Africa and Africa to the world.
We serve as a bridge between the North American market and Africa, aiming to increase tourism arrivals and investments on both sides of the Atlantic.
Tourism is becoming an increasingly important global sector.
From the north to the south, the east to the west, to the central regions, we work with the travel industry to promote and market tourism to the African continent.
This association, the African Travel Association, which attempts to bring the American tourists to our country, is very important for our economies. That's why we're here.
Africa is important to all of us in the world, and especially to all those of us in tourism that's related to Africa.
Our members include the public and private sector in Africa and the U.S., as well as a collective of young professionals interested in shaping and influencing tourism policies and opportunities in Africa.
This afternoon, we're going to discuss media and how to leverage media to drive tourism and to promote brand Africa.
We equip our members with the tools they need to attract tourism and foreign investment to their regions.
Talk about five different things that I think can be your pillars of using social media.
Through annual events in Africa and the U.S., we bring together industry leaders who shape Africa's tourism agenda.
In an association like this, you are now our partners to enable us Africa.
The annual World Congress, our oldest and most successful event, is hosted each year by a different African country.
We're very pleased to have our 37th annual Congress hosted in Zimbabwe, in Victoria Falls. It allowed the destination to showcase to our membership what was happening with respect to tourism, perhaps another side of what has been showcased by the international media.
Our annual U.S.-Africa Presidential Forum on Tourism takes place in New York in September of each year.
Tanzania is proud to be a sponsor of the Africa Travel Association's Presidential Forum on Tourism for the fourth consecutive year.
African heads of state and global tourism leaders highlight the role tourism plays in a nation's economic growth and development.
In order for you to sell and represent Africa, you need to visit Africa.
U.S.-Africa seminars held annually in Washington, D.C. focus on important issues with respect to travel between North America and Africa.
In addition, we organize promotional travel roadshows for African destinations and partner with various trade shows and events throughout the year to promote our members as well as Destination Africa.
Be a part of the adventure, be a part of the future, be a part of the Africa Travel Association, the leader of Africa travel and tourism.
I want to now introduce Eddie Bergman. He is the executive director of the Africa Travel Association to give his opening remarks. Eddie.
Okay. Well, thank you, Ali, and thank you for joining us once again at the Presidential Forum on Tourism
here at NYU. Your commitment to this association, to this event, to NYU, to tourism in Africa, to positive news is something that we are most grateful for, and we want to thank you and give you another round of applause for your time. Honorable ministers, distinguished guests, ATA board of directors, members, media, NYU faculty, students, ladies and gentlemen, ATA president, Honorable Walter Mzembi, thank you very much for being with us and not missing an ATA event. Welcome to ATA's 9th annual Presidential Forum on Tourism. The Africa Travel Association, as you saw in the video, was founded in 1975, and we continue to be stronger than ever, promoting tourism to Africa and focusing on doing everything we can do to convene the stakeholders of this exciting industry together to continue to come up with innovative ideas on what we can do to bring more visitors to Africa, to continue to advocate for the increased flow of tourism to Africa, whether it's through our research, convening power, ideas that come out of these forums. And we're just very grateful that everyone's here today, and we're grateful for all the leadership of the organization who's here, which I'll recognize shortly. We started this presidential forum 9 years ago in 2006. When I saw that, actually, I thought that 9 was the wrong number, and then I started counting backwards, and it was actually 9. So we've been doing this event for 9 years, and as I was talking with Yao earlier today, Yao, I think, had hair when we first started, and I think slowly has 9 years has gone on, has become wiser. Working close partnership with Dr. Yao Nyarko of NYU's Africa House, and since then, over 20 countries have participated in this event to put tourism on the agenda during the UN General Assembly meeting. Last year, we were honored to welcome His Excellency, the President of Uganda, President Museveni. Today, we also have a very impressive group of program participants and distinguished guests who will participate in this panel discussion. We welcome the Honorable Minister of Tourism and ATA President from Zimbabwe, Honorable Walter Mzembi. Thank you, sir, for being with us once again. We're also most honored to have with us the Honorable Minister of Tourism and Natural Resources from the United Republic of Tanzania, Honorable Lazaro Nyalandu. Thank you, sir. We're grateful to have West Africa represented by the Honorable Minister of Culture, Tourism, and Creative Arts from Ghana, Honorable Elizabeth Ofusu-Adjare. Thank you. And we'll shortly be joined by the Honorable Minister of Tourism from Uganda, Dr. Maria Mutagamba, who will be joining us in just a short amount of time. We also have with us distinguished members from the diplomatic community who are here with us, both from the United States and Africa. From Africa, we're very honored to have with us Ambassador Liberita Malamula from the United Republic of Tanzania, representing Tanzania in Washington, D.C. Thank you, Ambassador. We're also pleased, I understand, to have with us the Tanzania UN Senior Officer on Human Rights, Kintu Filimonina. Thank you very much for being with us. From Malawi, I understand we also have representatives from the diplomatic community representing the President's office, and we thank you very much for being with us. We also have with us retired U.S. ambassador to South Africa, Sudan, Indonesia, and Algeria, I believe, Ambassador Cameron Hume. Thank you for being with us. I understand we'll also have with us, and during the course of today's programs, we've received confirmation that representatives from the diplomatic community from Angola, Malawi, Mali, and Zambia, in addition to the countries mentioned, will be with us throughout the day's events. I would also like to recognize and thank today's sponsors for this forum, Ethiopian Airlines, Delta Airlines, which continues to be a partner and sponsor for the 2014 year as a premier sponsor of ATA, as well as today, the Tanzania Tourist Board and Tanzania National Parks. Thank you for your ongoing commitment to the Presidential Forum. I think this has become an annual tradition where we do the where we have the honor of using this forum where Tanzania presents the Tanzania Tourism Board Awards to leaders in the travel and trade, which we'll hear from shortly. And that will be part of this program in just a short period of time. And as part of the delegation from Tanzania who will be presenting, we're very honored to have with us again the Director General of the Tanzania National Parks, Mr. Alan Kajazi. Thank you so much for being with us. Oh, there you are. So I would also like to recognize and thank the 2014 official ATA Congress carrier, which is also a sponsor of this event, for the tremendous support, specifically for the upcoming annual Congress in Uganda. We're honored to have with us the team from Brussels Airlines, and you'll hear from the team very shortly, but we thank you for your support of this event and as well as the upcoming Congress. As well as our media partner, RW Social, which has organized the next the second half of today's program, which is a dynamic lineup of travel trade sessions. I'd also like to recognize members from the International Board of Directors for ATA who are with us today. We have our treasurer, who's responsible for counting all the all those numbers within ATA. We have a lot of zeros. Charlie Gatt, the publisher of Travel World News, who's been with ATA for many, many, many years and a leader within this organization and the travel trade. Charlie, thank you for being with us, sitting in the back. Yay. We also recognize Karen Hoffman from the Bradford Group. Please stand. Ogo Sau, West Africa Tourism Radio. Adele Black, I believe, is joining us, and Doris Wooten has also confirmed. And we also, from our International Advisory Council, we have Ethiopian Airlines, Tanzania National Parks, South African Airways is also represented by Cheryl. Thank you so much for your support and continued partnership of SAA, as well as Delta's represented today by Jason. We thank you so much for your partnership. Thank you so much, Jason. So, if I missed you, I'm really sorry. I'm sure I'll get a note and I didn't do it intentionally. Okay, so moving on. We also will be joined this afternoon by representatives from NAPAD, and that's in honor of the MOU that ATA has with the African Union Commission. And also would like to recognize and thank the ATA staff members and volunteers who have put so much work and passion and energy in today's event, in particular Angel Geru and Andrea Papito. I'm sure that you've heard from them, and we thank you for your amazing hard work. And also ATA volunteers, Declan Galvin. We also want to thank Regina, Maya, and Khalid, who have also been helping us with today's event, as well as the NYU Wagner Student Alliance for Africa participating in today's program. Honorable ministers, distinguished guests, this morning's program will feature an open forum on Africa tourism, where Dr. Yao Nyarko will guide a lively discussion with leaders from the African tourism, African leaders from the Africa tourism, from representing government from Africa. Ooh. Leaders from Africa to discuss tourism. Ali, does that ever happen on your show? Okay. All right. Then we'll have a reception in this room this afternoon just across the hall in room 405 and 406 from 2 to 5 p.m. We'll have the Africa Travel Trade Sessions featuring timely topics in global and Africa tourism with representatives from media and the private sector. This has been organized in collaboration with Ronnie Wise and Ethan Gelber from RW Social Media, and we'll be talking about travel trends, attracting the millennial travelers, and expert workshops. On a final note, we want to share that the upcoming ATA Congress is to be held in Uganda, November 11th to 16th, and we want to invite everyone to join us in Uganda. And for those who joined us last week, we recently completed a roadshow in LA, Atlanta, Washington, and New York, where we had both representatives from government and private sector meet with, I think we had about close to 700 to 1,000, somewhere between that range, private sector representatives at the various different roadshow events we had to learn about the warm hospitality of our Ugandan hosts, visiting the site of the equator, gorilla gorilla trekking. Did you know that Uganda is home to more than 50% of the world's gorilla population? And during the Congress, for those who wish to do pre or post tours, there's a 50% discount on park fees, courtesy of our hosts, for those who wish to go visit the gorillas. Adventure travel, visiting the incredible source of the Nile in Jinja. That's part of the host country day activities. So you'll be learning more about this during today's program, and particularly from the Honorable Minister, who will be joining us. With the theme that tourism is everyone's business, the Congress will have an impressive roster of speakers, as well as we expect strong participation from the Congress. Hotel rates for a beautiful top property is $115 per night, including breakfast and tax, as well as you'll learn about from Brussels Airlines the significantly discounted rates that they're going to be offering to bring everyone over. So it's really a wonderful opportunity to travel to Africa, travel with ATA, and have all the continent in one place. Following the Congress, on March 6, we'll have the ATA's 8th Annual U.S.-Africa Tourism Seminar in Washington, D.C. And now to the presidential forum, I invite Ali back up to the podium. Thank you, everyone, for being with us.
So the other day, I was, I often don't script the things I do on TV, and I had, as a guest, there'd been a deal concluded, as you've probably heard, between Israel and the Palestinian Authority on allowing construction materials into Gaza. And so I had on the UN ambassador from the Palestinian Authority. But as you know, the Palestinian Authority is not a member of the UN. They have an observer status. So when I introduced the ambassador, I think what I meant to say is, so as to clarify the context of this discussion, Palestine does not have member status at the UN. It's got observer status, so it's this is the difference that we're talking about. And I think I said, what I just want to clarify for my viewers is, you're not really an ambassador from Palestine. To which he said, no, I'm really the ambassador. And I said, no, what I mean to say is, like, you're not really the ambassador. And I think I did it three times. Fortunately, I have met him several times before through you, actually, Eddie. So he knew me and knew that I sort of understood what Palestine was and that he was an ambassador. And it was all fine after that. And I sort of managed an apology at the end of it, and he on TV, because I knew that I would be able to sort it out with him. But I sort of wanted to make sure that my Twitter feed didn't explode with people saying, are you as stupid as you seem? But it all worked out in the end. He understood what I was trying to say, even though I still probably couldn't articulate it. See, my desire for peace in the Middle East has nothing to do with peace. It has to do with decomplicating my introductions to people on television. I'd like to introduce to you Olivier Prevost, who is the director for North America of Brussels Airlines. Eddie teased that you were going to hear something from him. They are the host airline for the ATA's 39th Annual World Congress, and I'd like to invite him up to give some remarks. Olivier.
So good morning, everyone. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Are you okay this morning? Ready to go? Okay, you had a good coffee too? Right. All right, so I've heard my name is Olivier Prevost. I'm the director for Brussels Airlines here in North America. This year, clearly, we are very proud to be the official carrier of the ATA's 39th Annual World Congress, taking place in Kampala this November. And I would like to seize this opportunity to thank Eddie Bergman, Angela Gero, and Michel Avedian for having setting up successfully this partnership. Thank you very much. So, as I hope you know, Brussels Airlines flies three times a week to Kampala from Brussels and offers daily nonstop connections from New York JFK on Brussels Airlines and from many other points of origin in the US with our partner United. And those who would like to attend the Congress can already benefit from the discounted rate we are providing when booking the trip to Kampala. So I invite you to check the ATA website to access this offer, and I hope you will join us at the ATA's 39th Annual Congress in November. So what about Brussels Airlines, and what about next year? Well, the excellent news is that from March 29th, 2015, our Washington flight will be retimed to connect to most of our African destination from Brussels. And if you don't live in Washington, I mean, no worries, you will be able to connect to your Washington-Brussels flight from more than 60 US destinations through Washington with our partner United. Regarding new destinations in Africa, we're indeed exploring new possibilities of opening new routes to Africa, but at this stage, unfortunately, it's still very premature to make any announcement. Now, I will be remiss not to mention the Ebola outbreak in Liberia, Sierra Leone, and Guinea. Clearly, this is a serious situation, and we hope there is an end in sight. As you know, Brussels Airlines has decided to maintain its operation to these three countries, while many airlines have decided to pull out. Thank you. Thank you very much. We will follow the World Health Organization guidelines, definitely, as we do not want to leave these countries without connection to the other world. And I can assure you, I can really assure you, that Brussels Airlines, as we've always done in the past, will maintain its operation as long as possible, ensuring the humanitarian bridge between these countries and the rest of the world, allowing the convenience of medical supplies, humanitarian personnel, to those affected by the Ebola virus. Brussels Airlines has been a long-standing partner in Africa, and we believe strongly in the future of this region. Voilà, so I would like to invite you to watch a little movie which has been prepared by our local team here in New York. So enjoy the show and thank you for your attention.
Okay, not only do I totally want to fly on Brussels Airlines now, I want to go to Sierra Leone. I want to go to Freetown. I want to check out that ferry thing, and I want to talk to the mechanic on the plane. I love that. Very nice, Olivier. Very good. Much appreciated. I would like now to introduce the Honorable Minister Lazaro Nyalandu, the Member of Parliament and Minister for Natural Resources and Tourism from the United Republic of Tanzania.
Good morning. Thank you, Mr. Ali, for that fantastic introduction. I would wish to recognize Mr. Chairman, Honorable Mzembi, for staying the course with ATA and for representing all of us in Africa very well. And with this regard, I wish to recognize Madam Elizabeth from Ghana, as well as my colleague from Uganda who just came in. We work together in Africa. It will continue to be a destination. If something wrong happens anywhere in Africa, it does have bearing implication and impact to all of us. I wish to recognize and thank the chief executive of ATA for your leadership, but also for holding this beautiful enterprise throughout the time. In Tanzania, we recognize what you do. We will continue to support ATA, and we'll continue to do more to participate and also to work closely with our colleagues throughout the continent of Africa. I have my pleasure to recognize my own ambassador in DC, Madam Mulamula. She just walked out. But also all of you ambassadors, former ambassadors, who do great things to advance the world peace. We appreciate every one of us. And finally, I wish to recognize those who traveled with me, the Director General of Tanzania National Park, Mr. Kijazi. And by the way, he is a custodian in chief of some of the best, some of the well-kept national heritage that have become the world heritage. So Mr. Kijazi and your colleagues, I wish to thank you and those who came from Ngorongoro Conservation Area. On behalf of my country, and Tanzania Tourist Board and Tanzania National Park, I wish to once again say how proud we are to be a sponsor of the African Travel Association's 9th Annual Presidential Forum on Tourism for the 6th year consecutive. The country of Tanzania has played an active role in ATA. Since we hosted our first ATA Congress back in 1998, followed by a second Congress in 2008, as well as an ecotourism and cultural symposium, which took place back in 2003. And with this note, I would wish to invite every one of you for the first Swahili Tourism Expo that is being held in Dar es Salaam. I was just talking to my colleague from Zimbabwe. I had written a letter to most of the African ministers only to find he did not get my letter. So I used my cell phone to show him the letter because I had it scanned. We are bringing the continent of Africa to see the Swahili culture, but also the beauty that is in Swahili Expo in Dar es Salaam. It will be the very first. We are hoping to showcase something that has never been there before, and I look forward to have as many people as possible present in that event. The Tanzania as a country has continued to be an active member in ATA because we believe first and foremost in the vision of ATA. We believe in the role in which you have played in the fast-paced growth of tourism, not only in Africa, but very specific in Tanzania. And I wanted to mention here that our country is in the epicenter of something that is beautiful. Africa is on the rise as a continent. The Mackenzie group in London put Africa, and Tanzania specifically, to be members of the Lions on the Move. And we see ourselves as a country that is a reminiscence of the road less traveled. More people coming to Tanzania are rediscovering the very beauty, not only of the properties we have, but the people. There is something about our own people with African heritage, with love and passion in their hearts, that continue to intrigue and continue to make people want to come again. And I hope that the story of Tanzania and the collaboration we have with ATA will continue, and we will be able to see a good day together. We are moving forward this year to be announcing a 7% increase in visitor number from the US, making America Tanzania's second largest tourism source market worldwide. However, the Tanzania National Park continue to see the American market is number one in the world. It has eclipsed the European long tradition of being the first. So Europe images on the mirror, I like to say this, are much closer than they appear. The Americans are coming closer, but the Chinese are rising. A major factor contributing to this growth is the increased air access to the Kilimanjaro area. In north part of the country, I saw Brussels say something. I really want to talk to you and personally look you in the eyes and lobby. You gotta do the beautiful Entebbe, but you gotta also connect to Kilimanjaro. Every one of those airlines, as they will testify, coming to Tanzania, nobody has gone home feeling bad that they came to Tanzania. We used to have KLM, and we love KLM. You know, it's epicenter of the travels. Everybody uses KLM. But now there was competition from the likes like Qatar Airlines and Turkish Airlines, Emirates Airlines. Everybody would say, when you go to Tanzania, we don't know the destination very well. Maybe people are not going to travel. You got to go through other airports. But every one of those airlines coming have been very, very, very happy. And therefore, if you think of East Africa, the country of Tanzania would be like the size of Kenya and Uganda, from my colleague, combined. If you think of the Selous Game Reserve, this is something I say all the time. It's one single largest reserve the world has ever seen. It is the size of the entire country of Belgium. We are having it reserved for the generations to come. And if you think of Serengeti, I had a pleasure to stand by with my Kenyan colleagues to have to announce some good news, Ali. You need some of these good news. The elephant population has quadrupled in Mara Serengeti ecosystem. It is the first time that we've seen, and thanks to the American, great American Paul Allen, together with the Frankfurt Zoological Society and Tanzania Tawiri organization for undertaking such a scientific sensor for elephant and rhinos. We've seen that increment, which means there is something good that is happening between Tanzania National Park Serengeti and Kenya's Mara ecosystem. We are continuing to work together as neighbors. We will continue to facilitate and also work together through some of the security challenges that have affected that part of the world. Tanzania and Kenya promise to continue working together, not only for the common good, to preserve the Mara ecosystem, but also to look at other ecosystems that we share. And we see ourselves as the epicenter of the tourism coming into Africa, and we will continue to work together, and I hope the Brussels airline that you are here will think, and I'm gonna be talking to you, so that we increase the number of those airlines able to come to Tanzania. Let me quickly finalize by saying last year, we had, for the first time, Kilimanjaro International Airport became number one in Tanzania for the traffic, for the people coming in. And we also received a little over 250,000 people. That's 250,000 people of travelers who came to Tanzania through Jomo Kenyatta. So it shows the opportunity for the airlines to be able to compete and be able to do something good for the country. Today, the Tanzania Tourist Board Awards Program, which I'm going to announce, recognizes the contribution and the support made by the private sector in the growth of tourism, and it marks the 14th anniversary. The awards, and here I want to recognize very specially our very abled representative, the Bradford Group, Karen and your colleague, we appreciate you as a country for what you've stood for and staying with us during good times, as Ali has said, even during the bad times. And we hope and pray that we will continue this collaboration and relationship going forward, and we will define it more. The awards were launched back at the ATA Congress in 2000, and in the keeping with the tradition of announcement of the awards at the ATA event, we would like today to take this opportunity at this prestigious presidential forum to present three of the 2014 Tourism Award to the best recipients. Could you please, Madam Ambassador and Mr. Kijazi, if you could please come forward. And for the event in Uganda, we wish to announce our participation. We're gonna come strong. And probably this time I wanna go and visit the 50% of what you have. The first award this morning for the broadcast media goes to no one else than CNBC's Secret Lives of the Super Rich, represented here today by Ray Paris and Jessica Joseph. Thank you. And I want to tell this audience, CNBC aired a segment in June focusing on the Serengeti, which was shot in March by a crew led by Jessica. I had a privilege myself to fly from Dodoma, the capital of Tanzania, to Kilimanjaro, and be able to see every one of those super rich before they flew out. They were absolutely excited. Everyone told me, we're gonna come back. And that was a great sign, and thank you so much for what you represent and what you did. The second award for the Tanzania Tourist Board Airline Award goes to nobody else for this year, and for what they have done, and for the resilience, tenacity, and ability to attract customers, including those from Tanzania going to the rest of the world. This is Turkish Airlines. Turkish Airlines, represented here today by the very best Alp Osman and Mustafa Seva. We thank you, gentlemen, for everything that you've done. And this is in appreciation of your support in hosting Tanzania's first USTOA tour operator education trip. And last but not the least, and please, ladies and gentlemen, allow me to remind every one of you, never in your lifetime to forget going to Zanzibar, especially if love matters to you and having good time. Zanzibar will be a place to go, not as a tourist, as one of us. The last but not the least, third award for the Tour Operator Promotion Award goes to the Abercrombie and Kent, represented here by Norma Spadola and we wish to thank you and appreciate you for the tremendous support in hosting major broadcast projects, including CNBC segment, which we just gave the award. Thank you so much. And with these remarks, I wish to thank you and thank you for listening.
Thank you so much, Mr. Minister. As those of you who have been here before know, I have a lot of connections to a lot of things here. I was born in the neighboring country of Kenya, but I have made a good time of traveling through Tanzania, including in your Tanzania national parks. I've been up that beautiful mountain of yours twice, and a real pleasure to hear about the great success that you are undertaking. My parents are from South Africa, so I know the continent well. And greetings to the South African Airlines folks here, as I've enjoyed that airline a great deal. I was based in Atlanta for 13 years with CNN, so I know Delta well, although I'm about to fall off on my status there, not living in Atlanta anymore. And of course, I've enjoyed Turkey and using Turkish Airlines. So we're the only thing we have to do is Brussels. That's the one thing I haven't flown on Brussels Airlines, but the mechanic and the Freetown, I have no business in Freetown whatsoever, but I'm going to go just to figure out that whole ferry connection. So we'll have to fix that. But fantastic to hear the good news that is going on. I want to invite our ministers to the stage along with Eddie Bergman for the Forum on African Tourism. So I'd like to have the Honorable Phyllis Kandi, the Cabinet Secretary, Ministry of East African Affairs, Commerce and Tourism of the Republic of Kenya, Dr. Maria Mutagamba, the Minister of Tourism, Wildlife and Antiquities from the Republic of Uganda, Honorable Walter Mzembi, the Minister of Tourism and Hospitality, the Republic of Zimbabwe, and the President of the African Travel Association, Mr. Nyalandu again from Tanzania, and Elizabeth Ofusu-Adjare, the Minister of Culture, Tourism, and Creative Arts from the Republic of Ghana, along with Eddie Bergman. Please come to the stage. And I'd like to introduce Dr. Nyarko, the Director of the New York Africa House, New York University Africa House, Professor of Economics at NYU. He will moderate the open forum, and I'd like Yao to come to the stage as well.
Okay, so this is the open forum. And before we proceed, I just wanted to a big thank you to Ali. So Ali has been with us for many years now. As Eddie said, when I started 9 years ago, I did have hair. And then I had to shave it off as it was falling. And I just loved it because Ali and I both have no hair. And so I always felt this kindred spirit with him, and it's just always great to have you there so people don't look at only my bald head, but looks at yours as well, okay? So Ali, you've been with us for a long time through the thick and the thin, and it's always just a great pleasure to have him. We've seen him through his CNN days, now Al Jazeera. So please, a big round of applause to our very good friend for all these many years. Ali, it's been great being with you, and I still have your book, Give Me Back My Money. Okay, I show it to our students every time, and I recommend the book, by the way. So anyway, Ali, thank you very much. It's great to have you here. My name is Yao Nyarko, as was mentioned. I'm the director of NYU's Africa House. We've been with ATA and Eddie running these events for 9 years, as we just said. With ATA and the African Development Bank, have been putting out this African Tourism Monitor. I think the next one is coming out shortly, in a few months. ATM is what we call it. It's our belief that tourism, although it's the Africa Tourism Monitor, I like the word ATM because it is like an ATM machine, tourism is. It provides a lot of money. It provides income all across the country, different countries in Africa, and we're very proud here at NYU to be working with ATA to support all of that. We have wonderful guests, as you know, and I'm just going to read it from the list that I have here. The Honorable Phyllis Kande, Cabinet Secretary, Ministry of East African Affairs, Commerce and Tourism, Republic of Kenya. I believe she's not here, correct? Okay, so that's the one absent one. And going down the list, Honorable Dr. Maria Mutagamba, Minister of Tourism, Wildlife and Antiquities, Republic of Uganda. Could you please, so you know when she's speaking, she's representing Uganda. The Honorable Walter Mzembi, Minister of Tourism and Hospitality Industry, Republic of Zimbabwe, and also the President of ATA. We just heard from the Honorable Lazaro Nyalandu, MP, Minister of Natural Resources, Tourism, United Republic of Tanzania. So I just want to recognize him again. I am from Ghana, so I have to be very, very respectful to my own tourism minister, otherwise I'll get into trouble. The Honorable Elizabeth Ofusu-Adjare, Minister of Culture, Tourism, and Creative Arts, Republic of Ghana. Our very own Eddie from ATA, and I believe, yes, and I believe we're waiting for the representative of NEPAD, correct? So that's our lineup. We'll begin with opening remarks from the president of ATA, the Honorable Walter Mzembi. If you come up and give some remarks on behalf of ATA, that would be wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you very much, moderator. Let me recognize colleague ministers who are joining us on this ninth edition of the ATA Presidential Forum. Honorable Lazaro Nyalantu from Tanzania. Honorable Elizabeth Ofusu from Ghana. Honorable Maria Mutagamba from Uganda. And of course, our own son-in-law for Africa, Eddie himself. But just to say, colleagues, board of directors for ATA, ladies and gentlemen, all protocols observed. Let me just place on the agenda of this meeting or pose a few questions as we go into this presidential debate on how we can accelerate the tourism agenda and place it in the mindset of the UN General Assembly. I'm sure you have been told that this is the ninth edition, and it is a very popular side event of the UN General Assemblies, but certainly not the focus one, as is the case this year with climate change. And pose a question to you on how we can lobby, advocate going forward for tourism, this very important sector, to be the core agenda of a future UN General Assembly. And I say so in the background of tourism being senior and older than climate change, of course, but being a sector that we all know now supports one in every 12 people that are employed in the world, they're employed by tourism. 1 billion arrivals, 1 billion opportunities, 1.3 trillion in direct income, 7 trillion in gross domestic impact globally. And I don't know how our heads of states can miss this agenda in one of their sessions. So I just want us to reflect on that as we discuss in this session, because it is the policy session. And I want to submit also that the journey begins in Africa, in our regional blocks, and then mainstreaming this agenda to the African Union. I'm sure you heard from Eddie that ATA is a long-standing memorandum of understanding with the African Union. The United Nations World Tourism Organization also has just recently concluded and penned an agreement, an MOU, with the African Union. And I'm sure we can join the coordinates and put ATA at the center. I say this because as much as my colleague brother from Tanzania alluded to the USA being the chief source market for Tanzania, so is the case with Zimbabwe and the rest of Africa. And until recently, when the United States was overtaken by the Chinese, now the Chinese international outbound market is a whopping 98 million. And they are spending 129 billion on outbound trips. The USA just comes a little under the Chinese, and I don't think there's anybody, by virtue of the numeracy of the Chinese, who can overtake them. So we grant it to them. But the USA is quality tourism, quality expenditure. And the fact that ATA is placed in our mindset, the mindset of Africa, this very valuable vision of intra-Africa trade and trade with the United States. It means we must support your work and mainstream it to the agenda, first and foremost, of the African Commission under the UNWTO configuration. We have six commissions there. The one that is relevant to the work that we are doing here is the Africa Commission. And I would hope that the 57th Commission for Africa meeting, which shall be held in Seychelles next year, places ATA business at the center of its agenda, in addition, of course, to the combined work of UNWTO and the ICAO, which was going to interrogate interconnectivity issues and travel facilitation. Because it is central that we begin to really push, as African governments, push you in the fore in terms of the agenda for ATA, which we all value because you are contributing to our economies. And also, just to conclude, by placing another issue on the agenda, which is the issue around brand Africa. Our biggest challenge today is brand Africa. It doesn't matter how much we do as individual nation states, Tanzania, Zimbabwe, Malawi, Uganda, Ghana, if we don't fix the context, and the context is Africa, brand Africa, it will weigh us down. And today, as we debate about Ebola, Ebola is confined to one corner of Africa, in the West. But it doesn't matter because the geography is not easily discerned by the consuming public in the United States and elsewhere. Ebola is in Africa, because that's what their mainstream media feeds them. I was here just 2 weeks ago, a fortnight ago, and I was taking a walk in Manhattan here, near Times Square. This big banner, the red scarlet one at Fox News Agency, the one that rotates, it had this big message about 2,400 deaths on Ebola in Africa. So it doesn't matter what we do in Africa, as individual states, the consuming public is fed continuously, 24/7, 365, with this debranding message, because that's Africa being debranded. Now, it depends on how we respond to it as Africa. If we are not smart, if we don't behave like what Brussels Airlines has done, to say we'll stay in there, because that's not the solution to get out. The solution is not to inadvertently place a travel ban on the West. That's not the solution. The solution is containment and fighting the scourge as a collective. And unwittingly, unfortunately, many of us in Africa, a few countries, have placed travel bans on their own kind. The question is, what is the difference between a travel ban and a travel warning? Because we treat these two as one. We should be dealing with travel warnings. Travel warnings should alert us to the danger and how to respond to it. Travel bans, they are xenophobic. They condemn political economies to their demise, to their death. And I don't think that's desirable. So I want to compliment Brussels Airlines for your very patriotic decision, and I would hope that other airlines follow suit. We'll talk about airlines now in our panel. The future in airline business. The Chicago Convention, 70 years ago, kicking off basically commercialization and the order that we find today in airline business. 100 years ago, today we celebrate the centenary of the first commercial flight. What do we want to see going forward into the next 30 years when we celebrate the centenary of the Chicago Convention? How can we respond to the emerging competition between airlines, governments, and airports, which will make our national airlines pale into insignificance? How do we integrate our national airlines into global airlines going forward in order for us to stay on? With these few remarks, let me say welcome to New York, welcome to Africa House here at home, and I hope we have a mutual discussion that can add value and exchange value between us. I thank you so much.
Right, I just had to turn the switch on. This is a very interesting, enjoyable part of our deliberations today. It's an open forum. I'm going to try very hard to get a conversation going. I was giving our ministers a hard time when we're in the green room there. They're all politicians, and politicians sometimes give long speeches, and I said, I'll be interrupting every now and then, just trying to get the conversation going. So I'm going to begin with Madame from Ghana. I'm going to have her give a few remarks. I would like to congratulate Brussels Airlines for keeping the airline routes open. I think it's very commendable of you to do that. We're all very proud of you. I'd also like to, in public, we Ghanaians, we like to criticize our politicians, but here is one case where I think President John Mahama of Ghana, I think he's visiting the Ebola-stricken countries. He's going to make a public visit. I think that that's an extremely good thing. The United Nations has set Ghana to be the regional headquarters of the relief effort. So again, we commend the Ghanaian administration for everything they're doing. A lot of the airlifts are coming from there. And also, if I could put in a plug for New York University, we have our medical school, our dental school, and our nursing school are involved in helping the Ghanaian government, the Ghanaian healthcare system deal with these issues. We have one of our doctors at Kolibu Hospital as we speak. The head of our Department of Emergency Medicine, Bellevue, came back from Ghana, I think, 2 days ago, and is working intensely with them. So NYU's faculty and students are also on the ground in Ghana, helping with the efforts in the country. So all of those are good things. Life continues, as we just heard, in the rest of Africa. Ghana has been doing well financially, economically. Oil is there. There are a few issues with the currency. But I'd like to pass it over to Madam Minister, maybe make a few words about Ghana. What's the outlook? What do you think? What would you like to tell the esteemed audience here?
Thank you very much, colleague Honorable Ministers of Tourism here in present, the Executive Director of Africa Travel Association, Mr. Edward Beckman, executives of African House of New York University, distinguished tourism and hospitality service practitioners, esteemed members of the Africa Travel Association fraternity, dear students, distinguished members of the press. I actually bring you warm greetings from His Excellency, the President of the Republic of Ghana, His Excellency John Dramani Mahama, the government and people of Ghana. May I also seize this opportunity to thank the African Travel Association and African House of New York University for sustaining the annual presidential forum. This year being the ninth in series also provides a unique platform for African leaders, among others, to share some thoughts on the tourism development initiatives. I'm supposed to tell you a few things about Ghana, and it's a privilege, really. I felt jealous when Tanzania got the platform to sell Tanzania, and I'll not miss the opportunity to sell Ghana, even though we sell Africa as a whole. Ghana has a population estimated currently at 26 million, about the size of the United Kingdom, and is located on West Africa's Gulf of Guinea. It lies just above the equator and also on the Greenwich Meridian line, which passes through the seaport of Tema. This positions Ghana right at the center of the world, which makes her a choice and a must-visit destination in one's lifetime. The country is bordered on the north by Burkina Faso, on the west by La Côte d'Ivoire, and on the east by Togo. It is a promising country with a positive growing image among Committee of Nations as a standard bearer and champion of plural democracy in Africa. Ghana is renowned for her diverse and rich natural resource base, namely minerals like oil and gas, timber, gold, diamond, manganese, among others. Furthermore, a Tourism Act, Act 817, was promulgated in 2011 to support the development of the industry and to ensure quality service delivery. The Act 817, in particular, did not only transform our Ghana Tourism Board into a Ghana Tourism Authority with capacity to develop a sustainable tourism in Ghana, but also instituted a fund to support tourism programs. I'm glad to say that a tourism development fund is operational in Ghana and is supporting the development of infrastructure in Ghana. Distinguished guests, the justification for Ghana's commitment to develop tourism is the fact that Ghana is endowed with rich natural, cultural, and historical resources. Indeed, a key strength of Ghana's tourism appeal is the overall rich diversity of touristic resources. We have natural resources such as beautiful sandy beaches along 539-kilometer coastline. We have national parks like the Moli National Park, which offers game viewing and safari opportunities for ecotourist lovers. We also have the Kakum National Park with a canopy walkway, very exciting and interesting for adventure tourists. We have the Hippo Sanctuary near Wa. We have Lake Bosontri, and I'm proud to tell you that the largest man-made lake is situated in Ghana, and that is called the Volta Lake. We also have monkey sanctuaries in various cities like the Fiema Monkey Sanctuary. We have the Tofi Atome. We have the Boabin Fiema. And we have interesting landscapes like the Kou Mountains, the Ekuyapim Range, the Amejofe Mountain, and the Gambaga Scalp. All these interesting developments is in line with government's commitment to developing tourism in general and ecotourism in particular as a tool for the conservation of environment and local cultures, as well as new green economy growth initiatives. We are also housing two beautiful UNESCO-designated World Heritage sites, the Elmina and the Cape Coast Castles, which portray Ghana-European shared heritage dating back to the 15th century, as well as serving as transit points for the transatlantic slave trade, which took thousands of our brothers and sisters to the Americas and part of Europe. the reason to come to Ghana. The abundance of these historic relics strengthens Ghana's position as the gateway for the homeland for all people of African descent living in the diaspora, like Americas, Caribbean, Brazil, who desires to trace their roots. Other historical attractions include pre- and post-independence monuments and museums such as Kwame Nkrumah Memorial Park, W.E.B. Du Bois Memorial Center, George Padmore Library, an archaeological site which draws several tourists interested in Pan-Africanism to our country. The depth and significance of our rich cultural traditions within the country is the product of existing ethnic diversity. The five major ethnic groups in Ghana are the Akan, the Ewe, the Mole Dagbani, the Gwan, and the Gan Adangwe. Ghana's unique culture and traditions, which make a pleasant appeal to our tourists, is depicted through traditional music, dance, food, festival, folklore, handicrafts, and artworks. It cannot be disputed that Ghana is one of the few places where the chieftaincy institution with associated norms, costumes, colorful derbies have been preserved till today. Our culture is a prime attraction to many of our visitors. We also have major events on our calendar to make a visit to Ghana interesting. We host the Okohang and Paragliding Festival. We organize it to coincide with the Easter festivities of the people of Ko. We have Ghana Carnival. We have the Pan-African Festival of Arts and Culture. We have Emancipation Day celebrations. We have the Festival of Arts and Culture, all in Ghana. These events are aimed at not only diversifying the country's tourism and our cultural products, but also promoting both international and domestic tourism to induce tourist spending and improve local communities where the events are held. There are a lot of significance of these on the economy of the country. Having invited you to come to Ghana with all these beautiful things, I'll take my seat to allow other people to also sell their country so that you see Africa in a whole. I'll come back later to tell you the economic importance of our tourism. Thank you very much.
All right, this works well. Thank you, Madam Minister. So I'm just looking at my email here. Is Jason from Delta? Where are you? Okay, I just got an email. I just made diamond status. That's a big deal, right? Excellent. So I'm a diamond Delta person. And I want to thank you for continuing to fly from JFK to Accra. It's made my life so much easier. There are no British Airways people here, right? So there used to be a time where we had to go through London before you get to Accra. So, you know, bless your soul, okay? Delta is great. And on that note, I sort of want to keep this a little bit conversational for a while. Airlines, that's the first step in any American or European going into Africa. And you are the minister. So what could be done? What should be done? Is everything okay? Do you have any issues? So let's just focus on airlines and get a conversation going on. Is that a critical link in all of this? We've heard people say maybe we should have more intra, within Africa, travel. Is that what the issue is? Any comments, questions you want to give? We have Brussels here. We've got my Diamond, hi. Delta over there. South African Airways, yep. Over there as well. So we've got our airlines here. We have, so people would like to know, any comments on the airlines? Okay.
Hello. I think air connectivity is quite challenging in Africa. It makes the destination quite expensive. For example, when I was traveling to Angola, I had to travel from Ghana to South Africa and then to Angola. Certainly, it makes it expensive and not very attractive for our people. So we should make the air connectivity in Africa easier so that it will become cheaper. When it's affordable, then the air traffic will be better to increase our tourism arrivals in our various countries. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, our facilitator. And good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I was introduced. I'm Maria Mutagamba. I'm Minister for Tourism from Uganda. I must confess, I came in late, and I want to apologize for that, but I came by train, not from Uganda. But I've been in America for the last 30 days, and I've been doing tourism. However, I want to talk about the connectivity. Africa suffers a lot because of poor connectivity, especially within our own intra-connectivity. But on the other hand, even the interconnectivity between Africa and other regions, we still suffer because Africa is classified as one of the high-cost destinations. And this is because of lack of well-managed local airlines. I want to give an example. To fly from here to China on an economy class, you pay 1,780. To fly from here to Madagascar, you pay 2,960. So you find that the cost is so prohibitive for somebody who wants to go to Africa. And this is because of the so-called risk perceived to be on the continent. So at the continent, we have a number of things to do. One thing is to give ourselves confidence and exhume that confidence so that other people can see that Africa is safe. Secondly, is to fight the advisories, because the advisories are doing more harm to the African continent than any other. Because I would imagine coming to America would be equal and safe, but nobody gives an advisory on that. But we all come and we feel comfortable. So I would like to say that advisories are really doing harm. So we want to see, and this is what I will be talking on later on, that when you come to Uganda, for the invitation I've come to give you for the next ATM meeting, we want to discuss most deeply these issues that are affecting tourism to Africa. And of course, number one is connectivity. That is an issue. And of course, we also want to note, we thank our the international airlines that are working with us, like Brussels Airlines, Ethiopia Airlines, Turkish Airlines, and all the others. But of course, we have a problem of, if you move from America to Istanbul, you have a very excellent aircraft. But moving from Istanbul to Entebbe, you have a different aircraft. And so you find people really find that segment an inconvenient. They would rather stay in Istanbul. So those are issues that we have got to look at, and I think we can comment later on. Thank you very much.
Can I, let me just make a remark here. Maybe, I know there are going to be other speakers here, but can we hear also from the private sector? So again, airlines are businesses. They go where the money is. And so, what is the other side? What is preventing airlines from doing all these things that the ministers want? What is preventing you from having great aircraft going from one African city to another? What is preventing you from lowering the prices? So is there anybody who wants to speak from the private sector? I'm an economist here, so I'm probably going to say demand and supply, right? So do we need more competition? Is that what's going to get the prices down, or is it the costs which are too high? I think we have somebody here. Do we have a microphone for him? This is Jason, the guy with my diamonds.
It's amazing how technology is. Like, I can send one email and you're already diamond. But I have to be careful because I might be setting the wrong expectation for people. Good afternoon, everybody. This is not a public service announcement for Delta per se, but I am Jason Oshopakai, and I actually am a proud African. My father is from Nigeria as well. So to answer your question, which is we're going to be participating in a panel along with my colleague from Turkish Airlines, talking about airlines and the role they play in tourism. And ultimately, it comes down to this. As much as it's about profitability and the ability for us to earn money, it's also looking at the strategic fit of where we're flying to, and more importantly, where we deploy our assets. The security risk, without question, is a challenge, but But I think the exciting thing is that we're getting much closer with governments, particularly the ministers of tourism, as well as the airports themselves, in figuring out a way to work better together. And I can only speak on behalf of Delta, my former colleague. But you're seeing in the last 5 years a renaissance of commercial aviation, where historically we're making more money than we ever have before. That's the exciting thing. The challenge is that most of our aircraft is actually fully utilized, which means in order for us to fly more to another part of the world, that means we need to pull down capacity from where we're already flying, which now becomes a game of strategic versus profitability. But we also recognize that we have a fundamental role to play in economic development, both globally and locally. So I don't have a clear-cut answer. It's not A plus B equals C. But having said that, I think that we are very much open for business, and organizations at all levels are always eager to hear what is happening in the respective regions. And the last thing I will note is, in terms of what's been going on with Ebola, the company has taken a very hard look at this, and just as Brussels Airlines, we have also not really reduced our service to that part of the world. And I think that's a testament of our industry recognizing that we do have a role to play in terms of not necessarily listening to the hype and the fear, but really making sure that we're very strong and allowing the governments to do the work that they need to do, which is protect their people. Thank you.
So again, thank you, Delta, for keeping the travel lanes open to the countries, the three countries. Liberia, I believe, is where from Accra you go to Monrovia, so keep it open.
Hi, my name is Eric Tanner. I'm the CEO of Tripwing. I'm also an avid lover of the airline business. And I think the issue has less to do with just a general kind of continental issue and more to do with connectivity. As the airline business becomes more globalized, you see three major airline alliances, and those alliances dictate strategic plays. So if you look at Africa, you have excellent connectivity out of Ethiopia, where Ethiopian Airlines is part of the Star Alliance. You have excellent connectivity in Nairobi, where Kenya Airways is part of SkyTeam, and you have excellent connectivity in Johannesburg, where South African is also part of the alliance, the Star Alliance. You also have great connectivity in the Middle East with the giant Middle Eastern carriers. So on the eastern side, you actually have wonderful connectivity and intra-African travel. On the west side of the continent, you have a lot more trouble because there is no established airline locally that's playing on a world scale and has the strategic ties with airlines all around the world. That's the problem that I see. And so if any national carrier can get to that level, it raises the national profile of that country, because now you're getting access as a strategic play to airlines all around the world.
I know that there are further comments here, but maybe Delta, you can pair up with the new Ghana International Airways or something and become masters of the world or something like that. Please, Honorable.
Yeah, thank you. We look at the airline issue as the infrastructure. Just like when you build hotels, eventually people will stay, you attract businesses, et cetera. Airline is certainly an infrastructure that will allow a lot of things to happen. And that's where we have the most deficient, we have the most problem when it comes to Tanzania. And creating hubs, he explained very well, is a key thing. But most of these airline hubs do play very well to those countries or cities which host those hubs. If you were to fly to Kilimanjaro and you happen to fly into Nairobi, and many people do, I do many, many times, before you went to Kampala or you came to Kilimanjaro, Dar es Salaam, sometimes a ticket will be up to $700 more between Kilimanjaro and Dar es Salaam and Nairobi, driving 3 hours, maybe 2.5 hours. And it takes 50 minutes to fly. And that increment of $500 to $700 means a lot to a normal tourist. So it adds the cost of doing business and the cost of destination in places like Tanzania. And a lot of people, for example, coming into East Africa would either have decided to visit Kenya or Uganda or Tanzania. And for those who choose to travel to fly directly into Kilimanjaro, for example, they end up saving. And I think airlines have discovered that most consumers, including those in Africa and part of African countries where I come, prefer direct flights. If I have an opportunity to fly out of Arusha, out of Kilimanjaro or Dar es Salaam, straight to Europe or somewhere else, it is cheaper for me in terms of time and everything else. So first we look at this issue as the opportunity for the airlines to go to the new places and really experience. I understand, however, there is something that African governments must answer. And this is reality on the ground. We are faced with challenges such as Ebola. I'm so excited about the story that the Ghanaians are moving forward to support, and this is intra-Africa support. I think we gotta do more of that. And I'm appreciative of those initiatives. And we are faced with challenges from Al-Shabaab, for example, on the side of Somalia. And these guys are being adventurous. And with ISIS conflict in Iran and in Iraq right now, I think you see these bad guys being inspired. You see more activities. We recently had a situation never seen before where a group of terror group went into a village somewhere in northern part of Mombasa and actually attacked the whole village. It is never seen like that. Bad guys would come and just try to kill people in the village. So it creates a situation that was never there before. What we believe is that governments in eastern part of Africa work together more. We are interested in training more of Somali police force and sharing the intel. And I think some of these actions on the ground undertaken by the African governments to be able to answer the security question by bringing together our own capabilities and efforts and know-how, working with the international community, will make our part of the world safer. It will answer the question that the destination is East Africa. And by the way, even Somalia is considered East Africa. So even Ethiopia actually, considered greater East Africa. So we have a broader opportunity, but also a broader challenge. And we will continue to increase our own intra-Africa and regional cooperation to answer the security concerns, but also those health concerns. And I'm grateful that airlines would see this as a positive thing for them to move and work with us. Thank you.
Thank you. Let me have a take on this and start by saying 51% of the world's 1.1 billion arrivals arrive to their destinations by air. So I can never overemphasize the importance of air travel. Secondly, I think African governments must make a choice, really, on whether going forward they are going to be able to compete and withstand the pressure coming from global airlines and global partnerships, especially vis-a-vis their national airlines. And here I think we have to make a decision to right size and concentrate and focus on what we can do best. And I think it's regional connectivity and domestic and internal distribution of tourists once they have arrived. I think we can, with right sizing, concentrate and compete effectively. Thirdly, African governments must also make the decision and to walk the talk on agreements and protocols that they would have appended signatures to. And I know that we were not forced when we decided to append our signatures to the Yamoussoukro Declaration. It was actually just opening up African skies to other airlines and airline activity other than our own national airlines. And therefore, we need to go back and commit ourselves practically to this Yamoussoukro Declaration. The fourth issue is on the aspect of Africa's ability to raise a middle class. because what drives tourism really is the ability of nation states to raise middle class that can afford the product first and foremost before you even look out to international arrivals. And the case in point is one that I've already raised here, that of China. China has in the last decade been able to raise a 300 million people middle class. Out of those, 100 million have graduated to the international outbound travelers. So even as we fix our national economies, we must be conscious of the need to raise middle classes that can afford the tourism product going forward. The fifth issue is on the operating cost model. And here I have an example, perhaps coming out of my own country, where we signed up KLM. And in the last 3 years, they've been flying back and forth through Zambia to Amsterdam. So we had a direct connection, Harare-Amsterdam. The only reason why KLM have decided to pull out of Harare and Lusaka is clearly on a desire to optimize their operation in Africa through KLM, where they have, through Kenyan Airways, where they have a partnership. Why? Because our fuel is expensive. Our handling costs in both Lusaka and Harare are also very expensive. And these are issues that we don't grapple with on time. And the airlines obviously have to make the decision to cut their losses. And they've made that decision to pull out and consolidate their activity through an airline where they already have existing partnerships, and that is Kenyan Airlines. But they are citing the cost model, that African fuel, aviation fuel is very expensive, and our cost model is also out of the window. So we need to fix that. The issue around infrastructure, which my brother from Tanzania touched on, is very important. But unfortunately, we may see the tragedy of lack of integration in airport development. You come to Victoria Falls, one of the natural wonders of the world. The Zambians across the bridge, they have come up with a world-class international airport. The Zimbabweans on the other side of the bridge are also coming up with a world-class international airport, but that's one destination. That money, perhaps, which Zimbabwe is developing an airport with, should be going into improving infrastructure elsewhere in accommodation, because we have limited accommodation, 3,000 bedrooms, where we should actually be planning for 10,000 with one single airport on the Zambian side. So you clearly see the lack of integration between the two states, but the purpose is the same. We are trying to save tourists, and we are competing on areas where we shouldn't be competing. And in the end, I think we may end up with white elephants, just like we have on stadia in Africa. My country is bidding for AFCON 2017. And if we are not careful, build stadia, where we should actually be harnessing those that are already in existence in the region and doing co-hostesship and concentrate on milking the tourists in a very simple principle: get them in, get their money, get them out, get them back. And you make your money very quickly before planting airports and stadium. So I think product development and integrated product development is actually fundamental. I just want to dismiss the security aspect which was raised by Delta, to the extent that I don't think Africa poses a security threat that would stop any airlines from flying into them. If you look at the world's troubled spots in terms of threat to aviation, Africa pales into insignificance. We are not an issue. So I hope we can put this one into perspective. I thank you.
Let's move to another topic. And again, this is my role to putting our ministers on the spot. And hopefully my own country's minister will be nice to me after I've made these statements. Tourism is a business. You have to bring the tourists in. And so what are you doing vis-a-vis promoting your countries here in the United States? Advertising, marketing. We just heard from the great work Tanzania is doing. I think Karen's group is working fairly intensely with them. How about the rest of you? Any ideas on that? What are you doing? I can volunteer many students for you who would love to work on your country, promoting it. We have a lot of faculty here who are writing books about various aspects of your country, so I'm putting a little plug there. But what resources do you have? What are you doing? How are you investing? You have to get the message out in this community, in the United States. So you want to tell us something about what you're doing or what the constraints are or how we can help? Anybody?
Thank you very much. Hello. Thank you very much. I'm told that a schoolgirl learned about a tree for an exam. But when he went to the exam room, the question was a bird. So she said, well, a bird jumps from a tree to tree. At this juncture, one may ask, what is a tree? So that he could write about a tree. You know, even though I was not asked to tell you a lot about Ghana, I took that opportunity to invite people to Ghana by telling them what we have. That is what Ghana is doing to promote our tourism. We are attending international conferences, seminars, like we are doing right here, to tell people the good things we have in Africa. We are trying to use the electronic media as well. If you go to the internet right now and you click tourism.gov.gh, you will see a lot about the tourism potential that Ghana has. We also giving interviews to newspapers, telling the world what we have as a country. Because usually the news we get out there are not really palatable. But when people come to Ghana or they read about the things that we're doing in Ghana, then you see that Ghana is a place to be. It's not far from anywhere. Somebody will ask you, how many days will it take me to travel from the USA to Ghana? In 11 hours maximum by Delta, you are there. And if you come, you know that Ghana is in the center of the world. So we've used these opportunities to tell people to come to Ghana to see the most friendliest people on earth, where you get smiles for free, where everybody is willing to help you to be comfortable in this country. We have a lot of parks, we have a lot of waterfalls, monkey sanctuaries. I mean, you cannot finish looking at Ghana on 1, 2, 3, or 4 visits. So you must make it a holiday home so that you can see more. I think that we've used platforms like this to sell Ghana to show that people have to come. Thank you.
I wanted to mention something. I was thinking about the trend, which is rising. It's interesting. We see the numbers. This is about the conference tourism. It's interesting that the city of Arusha is attracting a lot more global conferences coming into Arusha, a little bit in Dar es Salaam. And the trend is, by and large, is people want to come, have their conference. You know what? Why wouldn't you have a conference in a place after... Maybe in 1 hour you can be climbing Kilimanjaro. It doesn't get any better than that. And with the Ngorongoro crater being one of the most amazing places in the world, or Serengetis and all those places, we are seeing the trend that we're going to continue to look at this issue on how the relationship between airlines, the rise of the appetite of the conference tourism, that we see the trend very attractive in cities like Arusha and others, and also the need for investment in hotels and properties that will allow for that to take place. That being said, okay, so an opportunity, and the scholars will actually have to look at what does investment in hotel long-term does to developing the destination. That being said, Tanzania would be not just another African country. If I give you just start, the entire number of elephant population in the great country of Kenya are only equal to one national park called Ruaha. The size is about 20,000. You are talking about a country that is massive. It has massive population of wild species. It's number one in Africa, considered second after Brazil by the World Economic Forum by estimates. And even with the plight that we've had recently for elephant poaching problem that was the epicenter of which was in Tanzania in the Selous Game Reserve, where between 10 years, you know, we lost almost 50,000 elephants by the estimates that was given. The trend is being reversed. All our efforts and properties and money is being employed to reverse the trend of poaching. I think by all estimates, we should be able to defeat poaching. Interestingly, we are working with the Chinese for the first time, hand in hand, to make sure that the world answer the question of the demand countries, and that the countries such as China do everything it takes to criminalize those people involved in importing the ivory products. And as you know, from March this year, ivory product really became more expensive than gold. So you see the appetite from Asia, not only China. We have all these Asian countries, for whatever reason they say, they love the ivory. Women have to put something ivory. You know, they say it brings luck, it brings good husband, you name it. We are working together, and the decision that was taken by the president of Tanzania, one was to put the ivory stockpile beyond economic use. And for the information, Tanzania has the highest stockpile globally, highest ivory stockpile. Right now, in my position, I have over 130,000 metric tons of the ivory stockpile. In a normal market, not black market, normal market is about $60 million. That's a lot of stockpile in one store. So the other time I hosted the British Minister for Africa, and I took him to the stockpile, and he went ballistic. He couldn't imagine. And they come from different type of history. So let me conclude by saying, I believe we can rise as a country to the greatest challenge of the moment, to stop the poaching crisis, to bring a stop to this menace that is happening. And with that, I think the world appetite to come and see the jumbos and to see the incredible amount of wildlife species, the Kenya-Tanzania Mara Serengeti migration of over a million wildebeest. It's never seen anywhere in the world. There is nowhere in the world where at a given time you will be, and a lot of you have been there, you'll be able to see 1 million wildebeest traveling together as if they were in a concert, and they would go in another country, live for a certain period of time, they will come back again. The World Heritage Committee named it as one of the world wonders, and I think it's amazing. So these properties, if we continue to invest properly in conservation, and this is what we are doing, investing extremely very well in conservation, in science or conserving. I think long term we have a sustainable tourism because of the safari destination that we have in Tanzania.
Thank you. If I may just, thank you very much. This was great. But let me just push the question again. And if there's anybody in the audience, private sector, what should the ministers be doing here? And we've all heard wonderful things about what's going on in Africa, but we all have to admit there's very little you see in the media. And I see some media people here as well. Maybe you can get together with the airlines and do some joint promotions. So anybody from the private sector who wants to say something?
I'm over here.
Okay, we've got the, please go up to the mic if you don't mind. Private sector. We have somebody there. Yep, please go ahead.
Hi. Oh, this is really tall for me, unfortunately. I'm Barbara Keating. I'm the president of Computer Frontiers. We have an electronic visa software that we use to facilitate governments in managing their visas electronically throughout the world. But there are two things that I think that the governments can be doing. And one is more focused on the United States government, which is AGOA. AGOA is coming up for renewal, as some of you know, the African Growth and Opportunity Act. AGOA has always been, or It has been found to be more useful to some of the oil companies and larger companies in terms of exporting into the United States. Tourists are exports to Africa. I think African governments need to be focusing on this legislation that already exists. It is an export, and that is what the purpose of AGOA is. And I think if you focused in that way, you might be able to use this legislation that's now coming up for renewal in 2015 to really use our government's resources and some of the attraction into your countries. And if you're looking for infrastructure and infrastructure development and those kinds of things as kind of an export in an odd way, you need to look at those kinds of facilities. And I think that would be very helpful as something that already exists that can be used. There are discussions going on right now, and now is the time to enter into those discussions. The AGOA meeting next year is going to be in Gabon, and so I think it's a perfect opportunity to bring those things up. And the other piece is that you need to try to cordon off funds of things that you already have. So one is the visa fee, and you can talk to me about that, but there is in many of the countries you probably collect globally between $50 and $100 million a year in visa fees. So how are you going to harness that to increase tourism into your countries? So that's really the challenge, and there's now new ways of doing those things and increasing security at the same time as pushing that forward in your countries. So anyway, those are my two comments.
Great, thank you. I'm going to ask that you all make very quick statements. No speeches, please. There are six people in the line on only this question, so please make it short. And thank you for the remark about visa. $50 to $100 million a year on visa fees? That's where all my money goes. Oops, sorry. Please, go ahead.
Sure. Hi, my name is Mark Walton. I'm a managing director of Onyx Global Marketing and formerly of the Africa Channel. And I'm from the media, so I actually could take a lot of time, but I won't. I'll be succinct. African countries need salespeople, basically. You need people that are here on the ground, very much like, as Tanzania mentioned, that Karen Hoffman and her group are here. You need people that are on the ground that are actually talking back to the commentary that is negative, that is debranding, as the minister said. It is your privilege and right if a news organization or if there is general information that's out there that you don't like, it's your right and privilege to have your ambassador or your representative here write a letter, to have your time on Meet the Press or on one of those news shows. News organizations are looking for controversy, and they will create their own imagery of a country if there is no response. So that's one thing. You have your right, and you also need somebody actually who's full-time who's working on that. Secondly, you need to use the diaspora media that are here, those Africa-friendly media that actually can help to spread the word a little bit more. And I think on this issue of collaboration, there is a vested interest from the American companies that do business in most of your countries to actually keep a positive image of those of your country in the forefront and not let the other influences take over. So combining with other groups, I don't know, Corporate Council on Africa, you know, this is a perfect segue to the AGOA conversation, to get together with the private sector of the U.S. to combat this. They have resources that can combine with yours if you don't have enough. Madam Zuma said it perfectly in her speech last year at the 50th anniversary of the African Union, that Africa needs to control the narrative. And that's not what's happening now. Others are controlling the narrative of what's going on the continent. So I hope those were kind of three things that were quick, and I'll be around for comments if you like. Thank you.
Thank you. Should control the narrative. Okay.
My name is Mabel Kashora. I'm CEO of My African Jewel. It's a marketing, PR, and consulting company. And Mr. Walton, he just told my words. That's exactly what I wanted to talk about. Africa needs to market itself. We complain a lot about the media. That's what they do. That's what media does. They talk about things. They write about what's happening. It is the duty of Africans and Africa to defend themselves, to own the narrative, as you said. Africans don't market themselves. For some reason, I'm in the industry. I've been in the industry for like 5-6 years now. You have no idea how difficult it is to get those politicians up front there to talk to you about marketing, about PR. It's so difficult to talk about the tourism boards to get them to market themselves here. It's as if you are talking about something they have never heard about. I'm not insulting you. I'm just trying to bring this to your attention that you can build the best hotels, you can have the best airports, but if nobody's talking about them, what's the point? It's what people think is happening as compared to what is actually happening. It's the image. If people think something bad is happening in your country, that's what everybody believes, and that's what the media is going to rally about. So please, let's market Africa, let's talk about it. If there's negativity, now they're talking about Ebola. The president was saying that he saw this Ebola thing. Call the media, go out there, defend it, say something positive. Thank you.
Great. So for fear that we're going to be running on this particular topic for a little bit long, so I'm going to change the topic slightly. You guys can stay in the line, okay? But let me just get another topic here. So one of the concerns many people have in traveling to Africa, and I think I didn't know the numbers were so big, 50 to 100 million. Visas. It is extremely difficult to get visas into many African countries. I repeat, it is extremely difficult to get visas into many African countries. I am, I think, blessed. I have two passports. I have my US passport, I have my African passport, my Ghanaian passport. And I change them every now and then, sometimes just for the fun of it. Let's see how much hustle I'll get if I use this particular passport. You know which one it is, right? When you go to Ghana, the Ghana embassy, is it $150 or $100 to get a visa if you are trying to go into Ghana? Ethiopia, I think, has a good system now. You can actually get a visa on arrival. Going from one country to another country, one African country to another African country, if you're on an African passport, is impossible, okay? I host a conference. I want my Nigerians to go to South Africa. It's difficult. Even when you're holding a U.S. passport, it's hard to get into some of the countries. So sorry for giving you guys such a hard time, but this is a big deal, I think. Maybe some of you can speak up. If you agree with me, can you please clap for our... Thank you. Thank you very much. I need your support here.
Let me have a go at this one. The borders in Africa today are a result of the partition of Africa that created the 49 to 53 to 54 states that we call our countries today. The Berlin Conference and its authors and architects have since dispensed with the borders and visas in their own countries. They are the ones who impose these borders on us. But in Europe, you enter one, you enter all through the Schengen visa. And yet we are still ourselves respecting those colonial boundaries. That's my first take politically. The second issue is that we have to advance towards a position where we relate visa openness to economic benefit. The G20, for example, commissioned a study in 2010, which has posited that by 2015, by liberalizing visa regimes in the G20, they would have created an additional 5 million jobs and generated 260 billion more income in their G20 countries. I don't think we have similar research in Africa that speaks to our leadership in the same manner, where we can say by removing visas, this is the economic benefit. By removing visas and by foregoing 50 to 100 million in visa fees, we are likely to benefit economically by creating so many million jobs and generating so much income. We haven't gotten to that stage, and I would hope that institutions like Nyarko University here and others are able to come to our aid to work with our African institutions to make this research more relevant to our African scenario so that our politicians can speak to the numbers and the economic benefit without just crying for removal of visas, which is not related to employment generation and economic empowerment
and revenue generation. So we need that as a first step. The last issue that I want to raise here is the issue on reciprocity, where African governments would like to do a tit for tat with countries that are putting them in certain travel categories. We normally classify visas in three categories, A, B, C. A, no visa at all. B, visa on arrival. C, you have to apply for the visa when you're still in your own country. Now, if an African country is in category C, with, say, 70% of the world, and it is the patient which requires tourists and their money, and then decides to reciprocate how it is treated by other countries, it will lose naturally. Because an eye for an eye only succeeded in leaving the world blind. I thank you.
Thank you very much. For us in Uganda, I think we have embarked on that and within the East African region, because you know it has been a debate over time, accessibility, connectivity, and all that. And one way of improving accessibility is to remove those non-essential barriers. And the visa is something that we think can be eliminated. In fact, for Uganda, we believe that by 2020, we'll be having an e-passport and no visas. But as of now, we are a tripartite. Uganda, Kenya, and Rwanda, we have a common visa. And you can get it from any of the three countries. You enter these three countries from any point, and you are free to enter and re-enter, and it is only $100. But for Uganda, again, if you have not managed to get a visa, you can get it at the point of entry. And another thing that has been very difficult, my brother, as you point out, is we have been working as segmented, you know, in parallel. The Ministry of Internal Affairs, which is responsible for immigration, moves in one direction, and the Ministry of Tourism is seen separately. What we are doing now is actually to bring the two together to work together. We are sensitizing the immigration department to know that they are the face of Uganda, that we people in tourism are marketing. So that is something that we have embarked on, and we believe it is going to yield results. On the other hand, is to sensitize the local people, because it is one thing you can even get over the immigration. You've got your visa, but as you get out, you find different people. So we are also now on a campaign to make sure that every Ugandan understands that tourism is the mainstay. And so everybody should be a potential tourist and be able to do business in tourism. And if every one of us gets that, one thing we shall increase our awareness, the locals, appreciate people who come in and also wish to go out. So those are some of the initiatives. I don't think I need to go to the University of New York to study that one. We only need to spread it and convince our leaders. Good enough, my president is convinced.
Just a quick comment.
I think we have one of your colleagues here, Honorable Edem Duke, the Nigerian tourism minister. Is he here? Is he in here? Okay. Why don't you come up, sir?
Thank you. Just a quick comment. We, in Tanzania, for example, we've simplified the visa regime. We've simplified it almost for every single country in the world with few exceptions. And we've made it possible that you can have visa on arrival. And the reason we fell short of doing away with the visas completely is because of a number of reasons. One of the key thing being, you know, we are in the part of the world that you need to be certain about security and people who come in, you need to know. And we are moving closer with our colleagues in East Africa with the coalition of the willing between Kenya, Uganda, and Rwanda. And we applaud their quick move to establish single visa. We think that is the future. You know, however, Tanzania, just like Great Britain, you know, we have certain ways of taratibu. We have to be certain about certain things, and you need to appreciate Tanzania has been the only country in that part of the world that has been the the home to so many refugees over the years. We've hosted people from Rwanda, from Burundi, from Somalia, with all this conflict. So you need to appreciate our own concern that we would continue to walk that journey, but a little bit more cautious. And we are making it, in the meanwhile, very, very simple to give the travelers good experience upon arrival or within our embassies in Washington, D.C., here in New York, and elsewhere in the world. And last point, for example, Tanzania and South Africa abolished visas amongst themselves. But another interesting thing that answers the question of economics, and this is subject for researchers to really look at this issue, whether or not when you give access to a poor country or perceived poor people, free visa entry, they would abuse it. The truth is, there is no requirement of visa between Tanzania the former British colony, what's the name?
Hong Kong.
Thank you. Yeah, it just went off my head. All along, you can always leave from Dar es Salaam to Hong Kong, no visa. So the people from Hong Kong, not the mainland China, if you are from Hong Kong, you can always come to Tanzania, you don't need no visa. If you are from Tanzania, you can always go to Hong Kong in that little enclave. With the Chinese fellows, yeah, you gotta have visa and to come, and we need visa to go. But generally, what I wanted to say, I think we've succeeded to making the visa experience, both the assurance in our embassies and missions abroad, much more easy, but also we're making it a lot more easy to obtain within the country. And we are open to continuing treating each country separately and increasing the number of countries that would not require visa to enter our country. Thank you.
Very good. So, Madam Minister, before you go, we have some people who've been standing up for a while. So if you can give some very, very short responses to anything here, as short as you can. What's that? Let's go 1-1-1-1. How about that? Go ahead. Very, very quick, please.
Very quickly. My name is Peter Burgess, True Value Metrics. This is Metrics for the 21st century. First of all, I love the idea that brand Africa. And I want to challenge Brussels Airlines for the idea. I mean, it's fine for them to talk about Belgian beer, but Belgian chocolate? I would argue that's African chocolate. I think the one thing about tourism that doesn't get talked about enough is the idea that tourism is a renewable element of economics. So much economics is destroying something to have economic value. But the nice thing about tourism, if it's done right, is that it is a renewable value. But having said that, one of the problems with the tourism model is that at the end of the day, the money leaves Africa. It comes to the airline, it comes to the hotel chain, not enough of the value stays in Africa.
Thank you. So this is a brand Africa, and how do we get more of the money to stay in Africa? Short comments, please. Very short.
Okay. I basically have a question. My name is Jasta, and I'm from Tanzania. My question is, that's for everybody. How, for example, in Tanzania, almost like 50% of our population is under the age of 30. How are we getting the young professions involved in the tourism sector?
Great question. The youth. Yes, sir.
My name is David Anoche. I'm a travel agent, president of Classic Travel. I see ministers talking about tourism, talking about branding, but I've never seen anybody mention travel agents. I think there's this missing piece in the midst of the discussion. Travel agents are the advocates of tourism. They are seriously the advocates of tourism. So without travel agents, there's no way anybody will know any place. So I'll plead with you to mention travel agents, put them in the midst of the discussion, because that's the only way they can tell people how travel is. They can tell people how good a place is. They can tell people how nice a place is. The internet is not going to do that. And I also challenge our partners, Delta, all the other airlines, to put travel agents in the midst. Thank you.
All right, that's the travel agents. And I presume you're from Ghana, sir, right?
Yes.
All right, a Ghanaian travel agent. Okay. Madam.
I'm Jenny Nayo from SAT, Society for Accessible Travel and Hospitality. I just want to bring the attention of all the ministers and the people who are present to the disability travel, which generates more than $16 billion a year in revenue just from Americans with disabilities. It's one in every five Americans who has a disability. And in view of the CRPD, which is a UN Convention for the Rights of People with Disabilities, which has been ratified by many African countries, this segment is written off saying that we do not have ramps, we do not have bars, but most of the people who have disabilities are people who are blind or deaf or hard of hearing, who don't need ramps, and also the diaspora who would love to go back to their country, who's getting old, would love to have the facilities. So I just want to bring that to your attention. Thank you.
Thank you. So we have the disabled and the diaspora. Ogo.
Mr. Africa, in America, that's me. Yes, I have a question and also comments about promoting Africa all over the world. I didn't hear from the panels mention the African diaspora tourism, African diaspora press. We are here outside of the continent of Africa and trying our best. We have newspapers, we have TV programs, and we have also restaurants, we have taxi bases, we have limousines all over the world, New York, Paris, London. And why Africans leaders, they are not close to their own diaspora, and to, because we are your ambassadors outside of the continent. The true ambassadors of Africa is the African diaspora, continental African who left the continent, come here, and make a difference, and promoting 24 hours Africa in terms of culture, the food, the music, the people, the economic. But if we are not together, how that's going to happen? That's why we are appealing the panels here. When you go back, please talk to your government, talk to your private sector. Let them know that they have true ambassadors in Europe or all over the world. Work with us. I asked two African countries, they said they was enemies of their countries are the diaspora from those countries. But you know, what we said about that, we said, if you have that problem, why not to use ATA panels and bring the diaspora and the leaders together? I think we can find a common ground where we're going to promote positively the continent of Africa. Many Africans, diaspora, in the press, they used to promote negatively the continent, but with ATA, that is ideas, vision, because he asked me to be his diaspora advisor. And now we're bringing the African press, really saying something very positive to the continent. But now what we're asking you to do is really to work with us. And we have here everything you need to be your true ambassadors, voluntary ambassadors, but I think if you do that, it's going to be a very positive for the continent. Like this point, because I don't know if you understand what I'm trying to explain is this.
So I think you're saying that the diaspora press, people like you, he has a wonderful radio station, and so ministers, please use the diaspora press. There are a lot of people here who are willing to support you. Okay. Thank you, Ogo.
Thank you.
Thank you. Let's get some very, very quick. We're running out of time, so please, as short as you can, please.
Okay, my name is Elaine Joseph. What I would like to see or know
Will it ever be possible to fly from New York, let's say to Kampala, on Uganda Airways? Will it ever be possible for you to have your own airline to leave New York and go to your country? That way you can keep your money in your country.
So this is a question about national airlines, okay? I think we have the last person.
Yes, I'm Charlie Williamson, CEO of Centrifugal Force Consulting Group and chairman of the School of Business of Metropolitan College New York. This is more about big data. So I know there's a lot of stuff around all of the great ideas that you guys have, and I heard one of the gentlemen saying there's not enough integration. Similar to an Amazon.com engine, you know, when you go in and you put in a search for a book, it always gives you more suggestions of things that you have based off of your profile, based off your frequent usage. Did you ever think about, and this is a reflective question, did you ever think about big data as a way of a central point in integrating the best of everything that Africa offers across the different countries?
All right, so that's a comment about big data. So perhaps we should go back to the ministers. Any of you want to respond to any of these? I know the Madam Minister from Ghana, I cut you off earlier on, so my apologies.
Mr. Africa. Yes. About the diaspora. In my introductory statement, I said Ghana is home for Africans living in the diaspora. So from here, I'm taking you to Ghana. And then I can say that we are poised to working closely with people, Africans living in the diaspora. I mentioned one of our flagship programs, which is called PanAfest and Emancipation Day celebration in Ghana. That is where we invite people, Africans living in the diaspora, to come home to see what we have there so that they can positively talk about the good things in Ghana. So we've taken notice of the fact that Africans living in the diaspora can actually sell Africa properly. And we'll continue to work closely to make sure that we take the gains out of that one. About the visa, straight visa requirements, we tourism ministers here are all added them that straight visa regimes takes away from tourism. We are all looking for high international tourism arrivals, and in one breath, it's so difficult for people to get visas to come to our countries. We also believe that if we work on reciprocity, we are doing an eye for an eye. It is a common term in the industry because it doesn't look like we can make any headway with that one. So Ghana, for example, is working very closely with the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, which is responsible for the issuing of visas, to make it a little more flexible for people to come to our country. If you are in the West African coast, you don't need a visa to visit one West African country. We move freely, and we hope that going forward, West Africa will get a common visa so that if you get one West African visa, you can visit Togo, Nigeria, Ghana, because we are also talking about regional tourism. And we are not there yet, but we hope to get there, and we are working very hard to achieve quite flexible visa requirements, taking account of our security as well. Thank you.
Excellent. So that's about the ECOWAS visa, West African states. When it comes in, it'll be great. Do we have some more comments there? Please, as short as you can.
I'll make it short. My name's Jamie Duffy. I work for Smithsonian Media, so Smithsonian Magazine, the channel, digital and events as well. And you had asked an interesting question about collaborating to underwrite an Africa program together. So would you, tourism boards, collaborate together to do an advertising program together in conjunction with, let's say, a Turkish Airlines or Brussels Airlines? And if you do, I would love to talk to you about Smithsonian Media, because we can develop something for you that's cost-effective across all the countries to promote brand Africa or your individual countries. There's a lot we can do, and I would love to work with you. So I'll leave you the magazine, but I really do would love the answer to that question.
All right, thank you. Let's get a quick comment.
Okay, my name is Hank Levy. I publish a newspaper here in New York, the Jewish Post, and I belong to a number of newspaper associations, such as the American Jewish Press Association, the New York Press Association. There's an ethnic Media Association in New York. And if you people would get involved with those associations, you would have access to a great many newspapers, possibly at their annual meeting. You'll have an opportunity to speak in front of them, to disseminate information, and to coordinate a media trip for the most important newspapers in that group that fit your profile of who you think your visitors are. There are ways to get more press out there, positive press, not only travel stories, but if you go to any of these events, you'll be meeting the editors and publishers of these newspapers, so that when something like the Ebola disease comes up, you will not be caught short not having people to reach out to get your point of view out. You will have names of people. You will have newspapers to turn to. You will have an opportunity to tamp down the hysteria. I think there's a great deal to gain by getting involved with a number of media newspaper associations around the country. I'd be happy to put you in touch with them. I'd be happy to talk to you about it. But I think it can be one of the answers to your question of how you can get more people to know about your country and to come to your country.
Thank you. Maybe we can get the Honorable Minister from Nigeria. Would you like to say a few words? I know you came in very late. I'll pass the mic to you. Tell us what's going on in Nigeria, Africa's biggest economy.
Well, thank you very much, moderator, Mr. Bergman, my colleague ministers, distinguished ladies, gentlemen, and men. I feel extremely delighted to share your company this afternoon. I just got off the aircraft about 1.5 hours ago. I knew it would be inappropriate for me to absent myself from here, so I took a shave in the toilet in the airport and changed my clothes. And I think in the true spirit of a tourist, I made my way straight to this venue. But I want to say that I'm extremely delighted to, you know, meet the rest of the afternoon. I want to thank ATA for the work that they have done over the years. I'm doubly delighted that in the year 2000, I had the rare privilege of hosting the ATA in Calabar, where I operate a small hospitality business. And little would I have known that 14 years later, as Minister for Tourism, I'd be speaking at an ATA forum. And I think for me that is a call to recommit myself, you know, to the sector, and especially, you know, to work with my colleague ministers to advance the frontiers of understanding of Africa, not only by tourists that come from outside Africa, but intra-Africa tourists. I say this, especially listening to a number of the comments and questions that have been raised by a number of people around the room. In the issue of perception, for instance, you know, the stereotyping, you know how it is. We in Nigeria are big and loud. And naturally, in some environment, that, you know, is not the most welcome kind of emotion or sentiment. But I want to say that a couple of months back, I was invited by the Minister for Tourism for South Africa to open the South African Tourism Week. And when I asked him why, he said to me that out of the number of tourists that come to his country, 30% are from the rest of the world, 70% are from Africa, of which 36% plus come from Nigeria. So there is prospect for African tourism within the continent of Africa. Several years ago, I arrived at the Nairobi airport and I was denied entry. Why? Because I carried a Nigerian passport. And I spent 18 hours transiting to South Africa. And on my way from Johannesburg, I spent 14 hours transiting to Nigeria. So you can imagine a few months ago, I was invited by Kenya Airways and Tourism Board to inaugurate a flight directly from Nairobi to Abuja. So tourism just has a way of catching up with all of us, one way or the other. I also would like to say that when we look at some of the policy regimes across a number of countries in Africa, you see that to encourage tourism in country, we determine that a number of countries around the world must be given tourist visa on arrival or would not pay for visas at all. But how many of us on the continent of Africa have such policies for African countries? We need to sit back and take a look at that. Because if we say that we want open skies around Africa and so on and so forth, there must also be that facilitation for us to know our continent. That is the greatest challenge. Africans do not travel within Africa. Therefore, you need the voice of an angel to advocate for foreigners to travel into and around Africa. We're doing a good job at it for now, but then we lack a number of resources. People across the room have spoken about the fact that we are indolent about marketing. One, we have a challenge of finances, and secondly, occasionally for me as a Nigerian, I used to think that there is a global media conspiracy of some sort, you know, about what happens in my country. And the good thing about us is that we are the biggest source market on the continent of Africa for African tourism. And we are so energetic that regardless of the challenges, we always say to everybody around the world, if there is anywhere in this world that there is no Nigerian, then there's something wrong in that destination. But we also advocate that there must be respect for African travelers, not just the Nigerian traveler. We have our own peculiarities. For instance, until recently, we were completely a cash society, which means if you wanted to travel to the United States, you just packed your wallet load with dollars. Just like back at home, if you want to buy a Mercedes car and it's $80,000, you took $80,000 in cash to the distributor. But that is strange around the world. If you wanted to buy a house in Nigeria and it was $5 million, you would go to the bank and you load up $5 million and you deposit there, all right? So you can imagine if you then arrive at New York airport with $10,000 in your pocket, it is strange. So, and you know the security at the airports in the United States, they come loaded with a number of, you know, gadgets around them, they're quite big, and so the moment they begin to ask questions about your $10,000, you become disorientated. And the media comes in, and the press in the diaspora comes in, and before you know it, there's a story out there about a Nigerian who landed with $10,000 in his pocket. You know, we need to understand that there's cultural diversity, especially about travelers of African descent. You know, it also goes to show that those corporate organizations doing business in Africa must also lend a voice to promoting Africa. British Airways, for instance, finds Nigeria as its most profitable destination in the entire world. But you'll never find a page on Nigerian tourism or culture in High Life magazine. All right? A number of airlines in the US, when they're about to go down, they open shop in Nigeria and they come right back into business. Talk less about oil and gas companies and so on. So we must find a way of getting them engaged in this synergy. I'd like to, for instance, the gentleman who talked about are not engaging media, Ebola, and all of that. When the crisis on Ebola hit the waves, there was such a frenzy in the Western media. In fact, there was stereotyping of all African countries. But guess what? When Nigeria effectively aborted the spread of Ebola, and no single occurrence is in that country, nobody mentioned it anymore in the Western media. Nobody said, this country has done this kind of thing, then it must lend its hand to its neighboring countries, and so on and so forth. So there's a general amamporization. That's what I call it. I hear there's some report, you know, that goes by a certain name, and, you know, we've identified them and so on and so forth. But, you know, I'd like to rest all of that. But to say that for us in Nigeria, we have suddenly come to the realization that oil is now a wasting asset. And Nigeria's transformation is focusing attention on utilizing the creative economy, tourism, culture as enterprise, as a way of diversifying the country's economy. Today, Pricewaterhouse says that Nigerian entertainment industry is growing at a phenomenal rate beyond global average. The International Hospitality Forum says Nigeria is the leading destination for investment in hospitality. The WTTC has a record of, you know, its study of about 184 countries around the world and says Nigeria holds the second most prominent promise for growth in tourism in the next 10 years. Their prospects, their opportunities, their challenges. What we want out of a forum like this is to work with bodies like ATA and other agencies interested genuinely in Africa to see how we can change the narrative. And that is critical, and that is what we would like to engage with the ATA, with our colleague ministers, and with the rest of you to try to do. And we believe that that initiative must start immediately. That initiative must start immediately. Governments within Africa are willing and ready to support any such venture, and I am ready to sign off on any such, you know, possibilities now and going into the future. We talked about our youths. It is important. We are beginning to integrate tourism studies in our institutions of higher learning, and also we are beginning to grow tourism clubs around the country. We are a country of 774 counties, and each of those counties has a unique selling point, a tourism product that we believe is marketable. We have been indolent in the past, but I'm sure that in collaboration with all of you who genuinely desire to help Africa grow in this sector, we will change this narrative. I have always said that tourism is the only business where you spend foreign exchange and you take only an experience away. And if we fail to market Africa, it's like winking at a girl in the dark. You know what you're doing, but she doesn't. Thank you.
thank you, Minister. Very well said. So I think, are you ready for a very, very short remark there? We have somebody standing up. And I just wanted to, again, remark that the minister is right. As we think about Ebola and everything that happened there, it was a remarkable success
in Nigeria. The man, Sawyer, I think his name was, came from Liberia. The doctors quarantined this person. He came in there saying he had a different kind of disease. They dealt with it, and I believe there's been no other spread of Ebola in Nigeria all this time other than from that one case. So again, it's a big success story. It shows that if the other African countries are similarly focused and aware of what's going on, this terrible disease will not spread from the three countries. So it's a great example from Nigeria. So thank you for saying that. We have the last question here. Please make it very short. And maybe after that, Madam Minister from Uganda, I'll come to you, okay? So please go ahead.
Thank you. My name is Susina. I am a master's in public health student here. I just have a quick question on ecotourism. I just want to know what the African tourism ministries are doing to create sustainable tourism and to help the local people take advantage of the local resources and change their life, also to like promote ecotourism and. Yeah, that's my question. Thank you.
Excellent. So we have somebody who is, did you say you're at NYU? You're going to be doing some great research on ecotourism and writing wonderful papers and all of that. Thank you very much. Okay, so ATA will be having its annual congress in Uganda shortly. Exactly a year ago, we had President Museveni in this very building. He was talking about economics and the physiocrats and Adam Smith. It was actually a very remarkable talk. And he said great things about his country. It's a beautiful country, as you all know. So maybe we'll pass it on to Madam Minister if you say a few words. And again, if you can make it as short as possible. I saw a long speech there, so I got a little bit frightened. So if you can keep it really short, because we are really far behind. This is a professor talking to politicians. I should be careful here. Please, Madam Minister.
Thank you very much. I will make it a very short one, and I'll put down the papers, because what I'm going to do is to extend an invitation. And definitely, you don't need to write an invitation in a speech. But of course, you jot down points. Ladies and gentlemen, as you have been told, the 39th Congress of ATA is going to take place in November, effective 11th to 16th November this year. And Uganda has been the lucky destination chosen to host this prestigious Congress. My purpose here initially is to invite you. I've been in America for the last nearly 30 days to trump up the invitation. I've been to a number of cities. I started off with San Diego, where we had our Ugandans in the diaspora. We invited them, and we believe they are coming in numbers. We've been to Los Angeles. We've been to Atlanta. We've been to Washington. We've been to New York here with a delegation of over 15 people, trying to invite Americans. Our slogan has been bringing Uganda to America and taking Americans to Uganda. Now we are talking taking America to Africa. That is our initiation. We hope and we look forward to receiving all the membership of ATA to this Congress. Uganda, as you know, is the smallest country. Looking at my friends here, you double. Uganda has got to be two times to make Tanzania, if not three. And when you go to Zimbabwe, it's much larger. Nigeria, Ghana. Uganda is a very tiny country. Asteroid the equator. It is called the Power of Africa. Because Churchill, when he came in 1886, he found Uganda the most beautiful part of the continent. It was all a garden. Actually, he called it the continuous rolling golf course of the continent. And that's Africa. That is Uganda. I don't want to entice you so much because I want you to come and see it. But what we are saying that this is going to be a memorable Congress, because we have really prepared ourselves with the traditional hospitality. You know, Uganda has got over 53 tribes, and each one of us know how to express ourselves. I don't want to demonstrate here, but I will do it when you come there. So we are actually looking forward to receiving you. We have a Congress for the first 2 days where all colleagues, the ministers here, and those who are not here are invited. I invited them personally. We have invited other stakeholders like church leaders, like media people, and even the fraternity at the UN has been invited. So we really look forward to receiving you. Coming to Uganda, as I said earlier, is very simple. You don't need a visa from here if you can't access it. You get it on the arrival. And we definitely we have a special desk for you to make sure that your arrival and entry into Uganda is memorable and easy. On the other hand, we've got a number of airlines that are coming into here, but I want to say here in a special way and thank Brussels Airlines that has offered to be the Congress carrier for 8039 Congress. So we thank you, Brussels Airlines. Other airlines are also at hand, like Turkish Airlines, Ethiopian Airlines, they all fly into Uganda. You don't have to come on the first day of the Congress. Please come earlier and enjoy the beauty. You know, all other destinations have been trodden, but you still have a unique, hidden, have that holiday of a lifetime where no other people have been. You will see the unique opportunities that have not been seen by other people. We've done a lot, and we thank the ATA management, Mr. Bergman and his team. They have been with us wherever we have been, but they have also introduced us to the American media. We are engaging the American media in all forms, be it print media, electronic media, social networking. We are doing all that to make sure that everybody gets to know that the 88th 39th Congress is taking place in Uganda. We want to assure you that when you come, we do our best to make sure that you come back. You come as a visitor, you leave as a friend, and you don't even have to leave, especially those of you who live in winter areas. You know, that is a place where it is permanently summer. The temperatures are between 18 to 28 Celsius, so you really don't need a winter jacket. You can even afford to sleep outside. We shall show you the biggest animal, the smallest animal, the tallest people, the shortest people, but most importantly, our cultures. Please, you are welcome. Karibuni, Uganda.
Thank you. So I think we're going to, Honorable Mzembi, you want to make some very fine, he's the, as president of ATA, you get the last word.
Thank you very much. I think it has been a very informative and vibrant session, 9th edition of the ATA Presidential Forum. To the African-American community, the last time we did some research on their spend in tourism globally, it was something like $1 trillion United States dollars. But that money is not spent in Africa, because Africa is not creating conducive conditions and an environment that is receptive to its own sons and daughters. And I got that point. So I dream of a future where our generation of leadership, myself, mother told me that she's resigning next year. I don't know whether she'll be part of the future. And my brother Mlandu and others, a future where African Americans shall be honorary citizens of Africa. They don't need visas to come back to their motherland today. So that we can tap into this expenditure, this spend. The issue about the demographic dividend, the youth, is very, very important. I think we must take it home with us. It's a fundamental issue. Africa is the youth and demographic dividend continent of the future. Many, many of our young people today will be workers tomorrow, and we need to find out what we're going to do for them. And this brings me to the issue of where are the youth placed in tourism going forward? I think there are only two revolutions taking place today in our contemporary times. It is ICT and travel, and with the two aiding the other. And I can't think of any demographic group that can be so involved with ICT than the youth. And they will make tourism more enjoyable, shorter in distances. And as you can see, they are almost about to make travel agents irrelevant if they don't align to this revolution, the e-revolution.
There will be e-borders, you heard that. E-passports. In Africa, we pay lobola before we are surrendered with the women that we marry. So there shall also be e-lobola. We don't even have to go and we pay lobola electronically. That is the revolution that is coming. So the youth, there you are. You know what we want to achieve with tourism. The beauty is Africa is virgin, it's untapped. In fact, talking about passenger airlines, Africa's market share of scheduled air passenger seats is only 4%. For a population market share of 15% of global population. So the opportunity is in actually closing that gap to make sure that we have our full share of scheduled air passenger seats in the world. And that's where the opportunity comes from for the youth and for everybody. And finally, let me just say, going forward into the future, I think what we should possibly take from here as ministers are the policy issues that are being communicated to us. And they speak to the need for us to have an African desk, I mean a tourism desk at the African Union. Because we have to assimilate all these issues right up to the apex where our presidents meet regularly. Because we can't move the agenda of tourism to the UN General Assembly in September until it's dealt with in Africa. So it's important to deal with tourism at regional block level. Yes, I heard about SADC, EAC, RITOSA, and so forth. That agenda must be at those building blocks, but moving on to Africa at the continental level, then moving from Africa to the UN. And I'm sure when we do it, this room will be too small for an African presidential forum that will be looking at the issues that are affecting us and how we can increase our market share of global tourism. We're only enjoying 4% of both arrivals and revenue, only 4%. And it should be our aim, this generation, that by 2020, that market share should be double digit of both arrivals and revenue. I thank you.
So on that note, yes, we look forward to continuing the conversation. Thank you all for coming here. I'm going to be handing it to Eddie in just a second. I think next year is going to be our 10th presidential forum. So again, of course, we look forward to another round of these conversations. But I'm going to sign off here and give it to the executive director of the Africa Travel Association. I think he has some remarks for you. But thank you all on behalf of NYU's Africa House for participating in this event. Thank you, Eddie, for Africa House, who's been working very, very hard on that, of course. Yeah, thank you, Eddie. And of course, you know, on behalf of NYU, thanks to the entire ATA crew as well. Angela, everybody, I can't see them all. Andrea, right? Okay, anyway, they're all here. Thank you all again, the ATA group. A round of applause for you too. And so over to Eddie.
Well, somebody has to thank Yao, so I'm right next to him. So I want to thank Yao, Nyarko, and the NYU Africa House team. And Yao already mentioned Eddie, but also anyone with the name Eddie is a good friend of mine. So Eddie, thank you so much for everything that you do. Would like to reiterate the thanks to the honorable ministers of tourism and the distinguished panel that we have here, who for not only making the trip to New York to participate in this event, but to ensure that tourism is put on the agenda during this week's UNGA, as our president mentioned, that this is something that we hope will continue to push. And I was very happy that you mentioned starting at the AU level. I think that that's the way to go. And I can see a future where in the near future, perhaps one of the AU presidential meetings has the theme of tourism. And I think that we as ATA would be very pleased to serve as a resource in any way possible to help to push that forward, to support you. As you know, anything that happens at the AU has to happen through the countries. So we have, as an organization, we have a MOU with the African Union Commission, and we stand ready to support. And we also look forward to meeting next in Uganda. We are very excited about this. I would like to just mention, in the beginning of my remarks, I had recognized a few folks in the room and some of our members of the board and International Advisory Council members, and not everyone was here, so I just want to mention, and I want to thank and recognize Bob Bruner, who's with Arik Air, another airline, for being with us, and thank you, Bob. And also, from the airline community, I just wanted to recognize one of our corporate members, the APG Group, and represented by Greg Truman, and also a very important air stakeholder here in the room. I also wanted to mention that we spoke about the climate summit and the theme of the UN conference on climate, and we talked about how can we push for tourism as possibly a theme in the future. And I know yesterday there was a big march for 100,000 people here in New York for marching for climate. I think various aspects of what that means. And I dream of the day when we can put a march together on tourism. I can tell you that march, I think it was a great thing, but I unfortunately, for me, it got in the way of my domestic tourism, because I was on the way to New Jersey, and I literally spent 2 hours going from 7th Avenue into the Lincoln Tunnel, and just was a parking lot. And so that was my domestic tourism yesterday. But hopefully one day we'll have a march for tourism that large, and we have to continue to promote that. And of course, tourism in a way that supports environmental preservation. And I think many people don't realize that this industry, if it wasn't for tourism, there wouldn't be that economic incentive to support environmental preservation in many parts of the world. And I know there was a question on ecotourism. So I think that's something that we, as an industry, we always I think try to be at the forefront of that and finding innovative ways to do well while doing good. And of course, thank you to our panelists, Honorable Minister from Duke. Thank you so much for coming directly from the airport. I recall finally in 2006, I think I see Doris and Ogo, we were traveling together, and we were guests at your hotel in Calabar, and it's wonderful to meet again and see you here in New York. I was very pleased you made the comments about how Nigeria is progressing away from the cash economy. Particularly, I think that helps with respect to tourism. I recall arriving at the airport in 2006 with some cash that for some reimbursements for expenses, and I got my first IRS audit just a few months later. So I think it's very encouraging that particularly for tourists, this is something that's really critical for the U.S. market. We don't travel with cash, and I think that there's so much progress that's happened between 2006 and today, and the world is changing so quickly. And finally, to thank the rest of our panelists, the Honorable Minister from Ghana, thank you so much for being with us. ATA has had a long-standing relationship with your country. And of course, from Tanzania, this is the fifth or the sixth year that we're having this, the Tanzania Tourism Awards ceremony. Thank you to Karen and the Bradford Group for making that happen, and as well as the sponsor, the Tanzania National Park. So thank you, everyone. And we have some snacks in the back.
So again, thank you all for coming, and see you all again soon.